So see there, A an electric company creates B. See there guys, the example, company A is creating company B, a power finance company. B issues 100% non-voting stock for $16 million to an outsider investor. See there guys, B issues 100% non-voting stock for $16 million to an outside investor, not to A. It is issuing to whom guys? B is issuing some shares to someone outsider, not to A. And now to A, they are issuing debt securities to A for $384 million. B then purchases an electric generating plant for $400 million. Sir, can you stop it there only? First of all, I don't know what do you mean by issue of shares. Guys, do you know what is the meaning of a share? Yes, what is the meaning of share? Why a company goes for an IPO, everyone? Yes, let us understand, because a lot of them are not having the basics, right? So yes, why do we go for an IPO? How do you know that your share price is this much only? Yes, quickly, 5 minutes brainstorming here. How do you know that your share price is, say, $20 or $30 or $40? How do you know that? You went into the IPO. How did you decide the price band, everyone? How did you came to know your valuation of your business? How do you come to that conclusion? The valuation is based on company's financial and market share, market value of the business. So what do you do, guys? You go to a, so normally you go to an investment bank, right? And actually go for an IPO help, right? So whenever, and what does an investment bank do? They will always see what is the competitor of that company, right? So that competitor, how are is his financial and what share price it is? It cannot be your share price is trading at $200 and the same company share price is trading at $50 or $60. I mean, why should I pay you a premium? What are you doing good than that company that I should pay a premium to your share, right? So a lot of the times your price to earning ratio, your earning per share, each and everything is taken into the account when you're actually finding out the value of a share. Now, my argument is like DMart is there, right? Before DMart was getting listed on the IPO, they compared it with other companies. Who is the close competitor of DMart guys in India? Yes, a listed company. Who's the competitor of DMart? Future Retail Next. Apart from that, who's the competitor? JioMart. Yes, Big Bazaar. Next. Yes, More and all. So see there, they have actually, if you see, DMart is an FMCG industry, right? It comes into the fast moving consumer goods. So they will definitely try to compare with all the HULs, your ITCs and all, right? So they will arrive at their valuations and they will see that what is a valuation metric we can give to DMart. And now you can see that DMart, when they have seen whenever DMart used to open their outlets, it never used to be on rent, guys. That's what investor observes, because they completely own that premises. What is the biggest cost in a supermarket? Yes, everyone, rentals can be a very big cost because that's a fixed cost. And normally, if you want to run an FMCG market, you always tend to go, actually, you can go in losses if your fixed cost actually exceeds. And in the short run, you might exit the business also, right? So that's where one good thing what DMart used to do, it never used to take anything on rent. Today also all the outlets of DMart are completely owned by them. And second very important thing, apart from the rental thing, second very important thing what they used to do is they used to purchase in bulk and they used to pay first only in advance. I mean, I've never seen a company who's paying in advance only to the creditors. Normally in an FMCG company, you have a creditors period, right? You will take it on a credit and you'll give them after three months, 4 months. But DMart strategy is they always take everything on beforehand only they will pay. And that's why all the distributors, everyone are very, very happy with DMart, because they get payments on time or rather before time, right? That's how a good model of DMart is, and investors really love their approach, right? So the valuations are also dependent on the management, their strategies, what they are taking it up, and how profitable that company is compared to others. So DMart was very profitable before they got listed on the IPO. And that's how, on the basis of that, they got a share price and they came in it into the IPO. So in the IPO, whenever they come into the initial public offering, so you're typically you will have the merchant bankers, everyone getting involved. And if you're undersubscribed, you will call some another person to do a minimum subscription. That's how the entire IPO process flows. If you're, it's normally someone will come from the investment banker to rescue it, right? In case your IPO goes for a flop. So they'll always have a minimum commitment whereby either the underwriters or the merchant bankers or the IBs who all are there, they'll come and subscribe to that minimum commitment portion so that the IPO is maintained, right? A lot of the times now you're seeing the current IPOs, they're all going as a big hit because of the liquidity in the market. There is so much of liquidity. You might see that they have listed at 500, but the share price on the opening day will be almost 800 to 900. We have seen in Happy Minds, right? So a lot of the IPOs which came in recently. So we have seen that they were oversubscribed so many times. Okay. So that's where you, sir. So are you telling us that they haven't understood the fair value of the share? No one will understand, because once they have understood that this is the market price as per our competitor valuation, how do you know what is your worth of the company? Only when you compare, you will come to know that this is the worth of your company. Okay. You will take the same principle, same valuations and arrive at your figure. Okay. So now, what is an issue of share? So you are issuing a share. So typically when you want to raise money in the market, so how can you raise money in the market, guys? See, to run a business, you need funds. So either you can issue shares or you can issue debt or you can borrow the money. These are the three sources of fundings, right? Share or bonds, right? Or you can directly borrow from the bank itself, like a secured loan or say unsecured loan or whatever it is. So when you are issuing the share, what is the journal entry you will pass everyone? Cash to common stock or bank to common stock, right? So equity share capital is credited, guys. Which concept are we talking about here? Everyone, which concept are we talking about here? What is the accounting concept involved? Share capital should be on the liability side. Yes, share capital. Why do we put on liability side? Share capital, which accounting concept? Business entity concept. Yes, not accounting entity concept, Kanchana. It is business entity concept. Your business is different. It's a separate legal entity. Yes or no? So I have issued the shares to the shareholder. So when I'm issuing the shares to the shareholders, so I'll have the people who will subscribe to my shares. And what will they expect, everyone? They will expect what actually? When they are investing in your company, what are the two expectations they will have? Returns, one is the dividend and one is the capital appreciation. So that is why they are investing. Else why will they invest in your company? Okay, when you issue the bonds, what is the journal entry you will pass, guys? In India, we call it as debentures. In US, they call it as bonds. So when you issue the bonds, what is the journal entry you will pass? Cash account debit to debentures credit. Incorrect. Cash accounts debit to bonds payable. Are you getting it? Not debt and all. It will be cash debit and bonds payable will be credited, or bank account debit to bonds payable credited. So this is the journal entry you will pass. And bonds payable also will be shown on the liability side. So now why will bondholder give you money? Yes, everyone. What will they get? What are the two things bondholders would get? One is the interest. And second will be what? Redemption. You will also have to redeem it at. So there might be different bonds. It might be convertible bonds, non-convertible bonds, right? So these are the two, three things which you will get. Now we are coming to the question of VIE. Is it clear, everyone, with the basics? Now I'm going to this question. A, an electric company, B, creates B, a power finance company. B issues 100% voting stock for $16 million because B doesn't have money. So they are going for a financing. So what are they telling? Hey, and give me $16 million and I will always give you every year certain returns. Are you getting it? Then only you will invest $16 million. Else why will you invest $16 million in your company? So B issues 100% non-voting stock. You cannot vote, but you'll always get the dividends and the returns. So B issues 100% non-voting stock for $16 million to an outsider investor and issues debt securities to A. Guys, A is an equity shareholder or a bondholder? He is a bondholder. Why did he do this all crap? We will come to that. B then purchases an electric generating plant for $400 million. How did he get $400 million, guys? From where he got? Yes, 16 he got from outside investors and 384 he got from A. So almost $400 million he got debt to equity and leases it to A for $12 million per year. Now see this, after getting $400 million, he's again leasing it to A only for $12 million per year for 5 years. At the end of the lease term, A must either renew the lease for 5 years or purchase a generator for $400 million or sell the electric generator plant to third party. Also, if B is unable to repay the equity investor, then A pays $16 million to an equity investor. So see there, A is giving a guarantee or not. Doesn't it look like an indirect guarantee, everyone? If B is unable to repay to the equity investor, then A will pay is what they are telling. So A is controlling B or not here. That's the thing. So control is very, very important. When control is established, should I consolidate or not? Who is the primary beneficiary in this case? Nicely, A is the primary beneficiary because he is getting everything what he needs. So let us see there. What all are the conditions? Now see the condition here. Equity owners do not have the power to direct the operations of the entity. Yes or no? Why, sir? What is the equity holding in this case? 400 million may only $16 million belongs to equity shareholders. So do they have power, everyone? And that also non-voting. So out of 400, only 16 million belongs to equity owners. So they don't have any power to direct the operations of the entity. A has bought debt securities of B, which constitute a majority of the investment. Agreed or not, guys? A has the power to direct the activities of B, which is to lease the electric generating plant to A. Yes, A is exposed to variable returns as A has an obligation to absorb the losses or receive the residual returns of the lease agreement, which is a significant activity of B. And B only receive a fixed fee. That's what we said. Only lease rentals is what it receives. So these factors points that company B is a variable interest entity and company A is the primary beneficiary. Hence here A has to consolidate the financials of B along with itself. Is it clear, everyone? What do you mean by variable interest entity model? This is how you create a variable interest entity. You created B, you issued nicely money to him, and nicely through him, you are nicely regulating the operations of your company. Is it clear, everyone? Okay, let us go into the next example now of a VIE. So see the Enron thing. Now Enron, so what Enron is doing is they want to purchase a factory for say $9.7 million. So when they want to purchase a factory for $9.7 million, they'll have to go to bank and borrow. Yes, everyone, rather than borrowing this $9.7 million from the bank, because you will need to show borrowing or not in your balance sheet, everyone. Simple question, guys. I want to purchase a factory for $10 million. I don't have money, right? I don't want to go via equity. I want to go via debt only. Okay. Now, when I'm going on the debt, I will need to show that debt in the balance sheet. When you have to show the debt in the balance sheet, what is the problem with investors? Your earnings will get diluted. Yes or no? Because your interest, you'll need to debit the interest expense. Your EPS will go down to an extent. Everyone? Yes. Do you agree with that? So what we are doing in this case is, what we are doing means I am not doing. So what Enron have done here is, so why should I borrow on my own? I will form an SPE, which is special purpose entity, or a VIE. Right? What were they doing in that 9.7 million? So they are telling through this SPE will go to bank, right? It's like creating a dummy or a bogus company. This SPE will go to bank and take money from the bank. No, sir, but why will bank pay to this SPE? Why bank will pay to that SPE is Enron will give the guarantee. Are you getting it, everyone? So Enron will give guarantee for $9.7 million loan, right? And this bank will go and give that loan for the factory to SB. Now nicely, you have removed your off balance sheet item. Had you taken on loan, you would have shown loan in your books, everyone. Guys, I'm going a little slow. Had you borrowed, you will show that borrowings in your balance sheet. Now, since that you are going through an SP, that borrowings are being out from your balance sheet or not, everyone. If you said disclosure means it's up to me to disclose or not. Why are we talking about disclosure here? See, I will not disclose also. You can't mandate that, okay? So SBE, so he went into the factory and he purchased $9.7 million, right? This SBE went into the bank and borrowed that $9.7 million and Enron had given a guarantee for $9.7 million. And also, since the entire factory cost was $10 million, $0.3 million they have given to third party also, so that it looks like a genuine thing. Are you getting it? So how does it look like? Pura Enron ka entity hai bolke lagega. Yes or no, everyone? If there are no other transaction, it will look wrong or not? So what they are doing? So they are giving some $0.3 million to a third party equity investor, which is independent of the SPE and Enron, so that it looks good. See, koi bhi fraud karna hai, you can form two companies. Say I am Mr. C. I'll form Mr. A and Mr. B. Sir, why do you need two company to do a fraud? Arey bhai, with one company I'll purchase, with other company I'll sell, and then whom I purchase from A and B, and A will also transact with B, B will also transact with A, and C will also be there, so that it looks authentic. See there, Mr. A, Mr. B, and Mr. C. You always need two companies to do a fraud. You cannot do a fraud with one company, okay? Because they can easily find out. If you have three companies, what will you do? From one company, you will show purchases. From other company, you will show sales, right? And A and B also will transact, so that it looks very authentic, that A, B, C are all different companies. So you will easily capture all of them under related parties and all. See, I am not here to show you how frauds are happening, okay? My objective is just to show you how an special purpose entity is used, okay? So here now, Enron have given guarantees and all nicely, and they haven't disclosed what is the percentage, guys, for equity method. Now, Dushyant was telling, sir, disclose. Now I will tell you why didn't they disclose. What is the percentage for equity method, everyone? 20 to 50. Enron have acquired 19.9%. I repeat it again. Enron has acquired 19.9%. So they will not come under the equity method. So no disclosures are required. Yes or no, it's a simple mere fair value method they will follow, and over, that's all. Are you getting it? There is no disclosure, no consolidation, nothing doing. So they were not even consolidating. Now they were nicely selling this to SP only. Even their sales also they were doing to SP. So can I now, since I have money, can I show my sales also to SP? Sir, if I want to show something as a sale, I need to show cash also from SP. Where is the cash SP is generating, guys? See, I am doing a bogus sale to SP. Where is that cash coming to SP actually? From where did he got? Nicely, bank. Bank, yes. I said you previously also why Bitcoin was introduced. Wherever bank is involved, there is always a fraud. Whenever banks were not there, fraud can never happen. Now what have happened actually? Nicely, banks are taking nice money from the bank. They are paying to SPs, I mean paying to Enron. Enron have transferred all its receivables also to SP. SP is nicely giving money. Their cash flow statement looks good. Yes or no? Normally, they should have shown this $9.7 million loan as cash flow from borrowings. Now, see there, they have changed the cash flow from borrowing to cash flow from operating activities or not, everyone. Enron have nicely disguised cash flow from financing activities to cash flow from operating or not. Had I been a normal company, I would have shown it as cash flow from financing activities. Now what am I doing? A financing activity, I have transformed it into a operating activity by showing bogus sales. Your sales are improving. Your operating activities cash flow is good. Investors are very happy. Lot of them from Harvard, everyone are telling, hey, come on, invest. And your share price is going up like anything. But in every company, there is one old person who is never happy. Are you getting it? Always there is a sadist in every company. He doesn't like this company is growing like anything. So he complained to SEC. Yeah, that is known as CT Wala, whistleblower. That whistleblower went and said, these all people are doing all malafide transactions. Please do an introspection in this company. These are all fake companies which they have formed. They have formed some around 50 to 60 SPs and nicely getting banks and nicely doing all their receivables business. So they are nicely selling all their regular. They are not having any sales, to be honest. That's a fictitious sales. They are only selling it to SP, and they are anyways not disclosing the SP in the balance sheet. So how will we know that this SP is a related party of Enron or not? Because they have already acquired only 19.9%. So your entire US GAAP have been gone into a, what you say, dustbin. Okay. Now, typically when you guarantee for loan, you should show as a contingent liability or not. As Dushyant is telling, forget about the disclosure. But is this a contingent guarantee or not? Guys, giving a contingent liability, what is the treatment? you all students study, right? In Suraj class, contingent liability should be disclosed in footnotes or not? No disclosure, nothing doing. They didn't even disclose the contingent liability. They didn't show that they are giving direct indirect guarantees. They didn't show that they were transferring the receivables nicely, right? That cash flows also from the bank, they also issued. So in guarantee, what were they giving? Guys, can you believe in the guarantee? They have pledged Enron shares there. Ye dekho, bankers ko. They have pledged Enron shares in the guarantee. Now tell me, after this news, Enron from say $70 went to $1. Who is the biggest loser in this entire case? Everyone. Not the investor, the banker only. Now he pledged the shares at $70. Now the share value have gone down to $1. Who is losing the money? Now where will he encash? There is nothing to sell also, right? So there is, where is the share price? There is nothing share price, $8 yara. This banker was nicely lending it against that pledging of the shares. So what will happen actually? Bankers will not get any money now. Investor, I've already lost each and everything. This is how was Enron fraud done, right? This is a simple way I have taken to explain how this particular fraud had shaped it up completely. Now, after this, there were stringent requirements on contingent liability. There were like substantial interest, which you see, you know, today, which you are seeing the words like big words, substantial interest, China, not 20%, 19%, because these companies were nicely playing last 10 years back. You never used to have this substantial interest word. It used to be only if you're 20% more, you'll follow equity method. If it is less than that, you will follow fair value method. There is nothing concept called as substantial interest. Either there is a substantial interest or not, yes or no, you can easily establish. See there, I'm just summarizing what all I have said. Let's say if Enron wants to build a factory for which it needs to invest capital, say $10 million. Now, instead of borrowing money and building a factory through the legal entity of Enron, it created another entity called as special purpose entity to build the factory. SP will go to bank and ask for a loan of $10 million. Enron will guarantee for a loan for SP. Bank will lend $9.7 million to SP net of equity investment based on guarantee of Enron. And for balance of equity investment, Enron would request third parties who would be interested in the project or affiliates of Enron to invest $0.3 million. In this arrangement of an entity of $0.3 million is 100% outside. In this arrangement of an equity investment of a $0.3 million is 100% outside of Enron and thus would make SP independent of Enron. And hence it would no longer have to consolidate the SP in their books, but the value of equity investment is minuscule compared to the project cost. And Enron is financing 97% of deal by guaranteeing the debt. Hence Enron is practically controlling the SP, right? Thus, due to the above, the concept of variable interest entity was introduced as a consolidation requirement so that stakeholders can see the fair picture of the financial of the company. Is it clear, everyone? Do you understand how VIEs operate actually? So I've given you one good example and one example where they can manipulate with VIEs. Now we will see what is he talking. Now, a corporation, partnership, trust, or legal structure that does not have equity investors with voting rights or lacks the sufficient financial resources. Yes or no, guys? In my first example, did I have voting rights? Didn't he issue non-voting rights, everyone? Yes or no? See there, they lack the voting rights is what he's telling. Do not have the equity investors with voting right or lacks the sufficient financing resources. Who is the primary beneficiary? Entities that is required to consolidate the VIE. Primary beneficiary is the entity that has the power to direct the activities like Enron and significantly absorb the VIE losses, giving the guarantees or receives the returns like cash flows. Okay. And then see there, the primary beneficiary must consolidate under US GAAP. Consolidated decisions are evaluated first under the VIE model. Consolidation is not required under VIE, then the investor will determine whether consolidation is necessary under VIE. How do I identify a variable interest in the arrangement? The company and business entity might have an arrangement. Business entity is a legal entity. Business fails to qualify. Interest is more than insignificant. The company has an explicit or an implicit variable interest like guarantees. Okay. Now, what is an arrangement? What is telling? The company or a related party has significantly participated in the design, substantially all the activities by its DISON are conducted on behalf of the company. Yes or no? Enron was controlling that. In the previous case, A was controlling B. More than half of the equity is provided by the company. Almost 98% funding was done by Enron. Securitization or single lease lessee arrangements are primary activities of the entity. In the first example, did we see that, guys? Leasing was the substantial activity of that company. Yes. Second example, we have seen the Enron thing. Okay. Now, what are the following types of entities that are not subject to consolidation? Are non-profit organization, NGOs, employee benefit plans, investment companies, LIC, and all these government organizations are actually not included. They are not subject to consolidation. So all the government companies, LICs, and all those sort of things are not covered. An entity with insignificant variable interest is unlikely to be considered the primary beneficiary. A term insignificant should be in the context of whether the variable interest is large enough for the company to even remotely be considered the primary beneficiary. So that's all we have under the VIE, guys. So see there, they have given an examples also. Guarantees, investment at risk, implicit guarantees, most liabilities, forward contracts, options to acquire lease assets, leasing. These are all the examples of VIE. So once the company has established whether the business entity is VIE, the business entity is VIE if there is an insufficiency level of equity at risk, right? Inability to make the decisions. So VIE cannot make any decision on its own. Can it make, guys? In Enron example, did SBI had a decision-making power, everyone? No. Yes or no? So they cannot make any decisions. They cannot have any obligation to absorb losses. They have no right to receive any profits. And there are only disproportionately few voting rights. Right? So there's hardly any equity involved. Rest all is actually your major investment. And who is the primary beneficiary? Consolidate. Once a company has established that it has a variable interest in business entity, the primary beneficiary must be determined. Who's the primary beneficiary? Who has the power to direct the activities and who has the power to absorb the losses or receive the returns.